webinar.
Yeah. Every now and then I like see a little bit closer to, I get that.
That
I stumped you. I stumped you.
That was painful.
Can we start over?
No.
No.
That was the one we're going to
leave. We're leaving it.
Turn around right now. Everybody sign up for the web. It's a webinar about maps. It's the webinar you've been waiting for. It's Prime Pro.
Okay, that was good.
All right.
Bro, I like
I
how
had
you,
to make up for it.
I like good. How you not only sing the lyrics, because very few people do this now.
Mm.
Sing the lyrics and
play the instrument.
Instruments with your mouth.
Yeah.
So you do the whole thing.
That was my, well, that's what I did in the band. Like, I was like the guitar rhythm guy.
But you didn't play the, but what do you mean? You played the instrument though. It wasn't with your mouth.
Yeah.
You didn't show up with just the mic.
Oh, I'm playing with my mouth or something.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I didn't notice that.
So,
I'm special.
On the 13th, we're doing a live webinar. It's free to anybody. Who registers, and it's us going through our newest MAPS program. We have not released yet. It's MAPS Prime Pro. It is, of all of our programs, the most corrective in nature. Really, really getting down to the nitty-gritty of all the distal joints, the wrists, the hands, the fingers, the feet, the ankles, the knees, the your spine. I mean, it really goes down in detail, and it teaches you how to self-assess and then how to correct issues with those areas so that not only do you avoid things like injury and pain and dysfunction, but you actually improve on all of your major lifts, and along with that comes better results. And for the first time, what we're doing is we're actually going to go over it and kind of go through it for free. So it's not like you're going to literally get on the webinar and we're going to show you the tests and teach you how to perform the tests.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to teach you movements to correct imbalances that you may find within these tests.
We're going to have Dr. Brink there with us, like really describing all the coaching cues and the things to look out for as you're performing these exercises and these different techniques that are really going to take your toolbox, your tool set, and it's going to expand on it on an incredible level.
And it's not going to be open for free forever. We're going to keep it open for free for now. We don't want a ton of people on it, so it's better to get on now, sooner rather than later, because there is a feedback, I think, option on the webinar. Doug was talking about how you can chat and ask questions and stuff, and we want to be able to have that opportunity to answer people's questions. So I highly recommend, you're hearing this now, go on there and register now, and that way you get in the webinar for free. The site that you go to is MAPSPrimePro.com. So that's MAPS, MAPS, Prime, PRIME, and then Pro, PRO.com. And then you just sign up for it. And then on the 13th, you get to watch the webinar.
Let's roll.
If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump with your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, in the beginning, me and Justin make fun of Adam for a quick second, but then he comes back and explains what's going on.
Yeah.
We talk a lot about mobility, and then we talk about the benefits and detriments of unilateral training. That's where you train one side of your body at a time, versus barbell training, where you're training both sides. What are the pluses and what are the minuses of each, and how would you incorporate both of them to maximize your overall results? And then we get into some diet reviews. We actually review.
This is where it gets spicy.
We went on. Doug went online and he found 5 popular celebrity diets, and we broke them down and reviewed them, and told everybody which ones are good, which ones are bad, and which ones are absolutely horrible. The diets we go over are the 5-factor diet. Then we talk about the pressed juicery diet, the alkaline diet. We talk about Kourtney Kardashian's diet. And then we talk about our favorite, the M plan.
Yeah.
We teach you all about these, and then we tell you if you should waste your time
Here's the secret. It's magic.
Exactly.
Yeah.
In this episode, check it out. Dude, how funny, Justin, how funny was it? Were you getting the same feeling I was getting yesterday when Adam was demoing his...
Yes.
So Adam did this real impressive, very impressive thing, especially for a big dude. He did a... From his knees, jumped to a pistol squat... Came up, bent over, all on one leg, never switched legs or anything, or went on both legs, and then did a single leg deadlift with 100-pound dumbbells in each hand. Mm-hmm. Very impressive. He had to practice a few times doing it to kind of get the hang of it, right? Because it's a it's a skill, it's a technique.
You're talking about being nervous when Jordy got in there?
Yeah. Oh, and then he just like, did it like...
He just does it real quick. I'm like, oh no!
We're like, oh yeah, he's got youth.
We're getting old.
Yeah. Although I think mechanically, I think it was my form was a little bit safer.
That's the wisdom part, right? Yeah, that's what we at least
have.
Because
I was going like, oh God, my back. Well, I was like,
it's like we can make it look pretty, and then afterwards we're like immediately
red.
Dude,
at some point, guys, I hate to break this to us because I'm breaking this to myself too because I don't like to talk about this
quite a bit.
At some point, you're going to get your ass kicked in some way, shape, or form by some dude, mainly because he's younger, not because he's...
And then they just make it look really easy.
That's what Cars 3 is like all about that.
No wonder you didn't like it.
Cars
3. Bullshit. This is bullshit. This isn't true.
Yeah, no. That's why you always have to just make more money than them. I guess you always throw that at them. Like, oh, wow.
We totally win.
One up them some other way, right?
Wow, you've got crazy energy. That's awesome.
Cool. How many books have you read this month?
Oh, yeah.
That's cool.
How much life experience.
Yeah, you see my watch, it costs more than your car. Yeah. Isn't that weird?
Yeah,
you know, little peeing contest.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, did you guys work out yet today?
No,
not yet.
Why?
Why?
You're the only guy that really likes to do the morning.
When?
Workouts.
Like when? What time?
So what,
I haven't had time today.
What's your trainings look like right now, Justin? Are you following a set? Like this is my goal. This is what I'm doing. Or are you going? Or you just go in there and decide I'm going to do this and
have
do that.
Have you bought any online programs lately?
Yeah, like, what's your deal?
I bought a few. Yeah. No, I don't do that. Like, I have a very specific kind of agenda in my head. Like, I got to accomplish at least, like, two of these compound lifts. Like, for me, if I could just stick with that, I create a workout around that.
So, what's today's compound lift choices?
So, today is squats and overhead press. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Last time, yeah.
I see you're going with the exotic lifts.
Very exotic. Very
I could have guessed that. Yeah. Like, let me think. What is Justin's
But you know what? I'll be honest. I'm actually going to incorporate some, like, Bulgarian split squats. I've been, like, listening to people talk about them a lot lately. And
What's up with that?
I don't know. You know what it is? It's unilateral training is getting a lot of attention because there's a little bit of controversy, actually. Like, I was just listening to a conversation with Mike Boyle talking about why he doesn't do backloaded squats and was articulating his rationale for that with his athletes and the way that he trains. And actually, he presented a pretty decent argument with it.
I feel like I can argue that. I think there's a lot of – I mean, when you think about when we walk – we're always in a semi-single leg squat or split stance or ball game. I mean, that's...
It's really about the... And who is it? Dr. Jordan Shallow explained how having one of the legs going back and one of them forward places the pelvis in a particular position that is very functional in terms of how it displays strength.
Mm-hmm.
But when, of course, like everything, right? Someone will be like, oh, this is why it's better. So that's all you should do.
Yeah. No. And I think, too, like to his credit, though, like he kind of, I mean, his mentality is I'm doing what works with my athletes that I test out every single day. And so he kind of looks at a lot of current, like researched items that are getting more notoriety and like certain gurus that kind of pop up that have a very specific research backing idea. And he sort of either takes it, you know, with like, I've been doing that already or that's something I haven't been doing. I'm going to try it out or I'm not going to listen to it because I, you know, this is actually working.
So here's a theory that I would have on comparing, let's say, a split stance squat or a lunge or a Bulgarian split stance squat or versus a barbell squat. If you were to compare, and this is just my prediction, if this study were created, if you were to compare groups to see which one resulted in more functional carryover strength to, let's say, some kind of a strength-based type sport, maybe like football or something like that with a little bit of aerobic, but mostly anaerobic.
Mm-hmm.
I think in the short term, the back squat would result in better results. And then maybe in the long term, you'd start to see that the split stance stuff would be better. And the reason why I think in the short term, the squat would be better is there's less skill involved. Mm. So you can get into squat, learn it kind of faster, and then really start to maximize output. Whereas with the split stance stuff, there's a lot, it's just more balance involved, more skill maybe to involve.
Well, I look at it as like a foundational strength pattern that you're able to load a significant amount on your back and have it evenly displaced. And so that's going to generate more intrinsic force to overcome those, external forces.
Now, you're doing it with a bar on your back.
The argument to that would be like, when and ever a sport are you perfectly
exactly
balanced?
But
on two
like
feet,
I
right?
said, as a foundational strength to pull from, so you've increased your capacity for more strength. Now I'm going to focus on my skills. I'm going to strengthen, from a unilateral perspective, because that's what I'm going to be functioning with primarily.
So that's always an argument, right? And that's been around for a long time. Like, when am I using, when am I bench pressing in this sport? When am I rowing in this sport? So for a little while, their trainers were literally taking the movements from the sport and mimicking them with resistance, but
like
we know how
super specialized.
But we know how bad that worked.
Right.
It didn't work very well at all.
The way they thought.
I think strength. There's a couple things with strength that you want to look at. Number one, it's a skill. So there's a lot of skill involved with the strength, which is why it's important to practice your sport while you're training. Because if you just get stronger and don't practice applying that strength, it doesn't mean anything. But
your skill will diminish. Based off frequency.
Exactly. And at the end of the day, though, like maximal strength is kind of that foundation that contributes so much more to the other pursuits than the other pursuits do to the other one. So, like, it's going to make you faster. It's going to make you more explosive. It's going to increase, balance, stability, more so than in terms of contributing to other factors,
mm-hmm.
more so than the other individual factors. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I think, like, if you take, like, a boxer, you're not just doing resistance with a punch, which actually, believe it or not, is terrible for boxing because it throws your timing off.
Mm-hmm.
But they're going to do great from getting some base strength and then applying that maybe in the ring with their training and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That's my opinion.
Well, what I find with the unilateral stuff, especially with legs, like when you talk about a single leg squat, Bulgarian split stance, a single leg deadlift, which you've seen me doing recently, it's really amazing when, especially if you do stuff like barefoot, right? So I'll go do like that single leg deadlift really heavy barefoot, like 3 reps. And then after I do that on each side, it's amazing to go grab a barbell and go do 400-pound deadlift and feel how connected I am to the ground because of the stabilization and the control that you have to have on a single leg.
Yeah.
Everything has to be – there's no room for error. Like or less room for error.
Yeah, I like evaluating that, like your true strength with a balanced – form of that. So therefore, if I split, I'm working on one individual side at a time to build them up. But I don't want to get too far, where I'm over dominant on one side versus the other, which could happen. But like, I want to be able to express, an overall strength pattern. And so that's why I do still stick with barbell training, because it's not very specific, sport specific, but that's like, I want to see how that's translating to overall strength. And then also, how do I express that in a more functional pattern with
that? There's definitely a balance component that results in more muscle and strength. I will say that. I'll argue that all day long. And this is one of the reasons why free weights, in my experience, and most people will agree with this, at least most trainers will, build more muscle than machines that mimic free weights. So like, you could do a bench press versus a machine chest press, or a deadlift versus a machine deadlift, or, mm-hmm. And the free weight ones tend to just build more muscle and more strength. And that, I think, has to do with the balance component. But then there's almost like a negative, like a diminishing returns, then it becomes negative when it becomes too much. Because
mm-hmm.
if we keep pushing that, and have people stand on a physio ball or do everything, on uneven surfaces and stuff like that, then you stop getting that effect. So this is almost like this.
Mm-hmm.
It would be interesting to draw a graph to kind of measure that. Like, here's the benefit. Now you went too far.
Yeah.
And now there's detriment, because barbells, and you're doing two things on two legs, they tend to build more muscle than the single leg or individual type, unilateral type movements. Now, of course, that's on a versus you know, one-to-one basis, but right. Of course you want to do both, right?
Well, that's, and like also, like, I think he argues too, a lot of times, like, the pursuit of just building more muscle may not be to your benefit.
You right. For sports, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, well, you have to evaluate the why, and I think that the conversation I actually did agree with, which, you know, I mean, some of that, like, he made good points. I'm not saying I agree with it, but... you know, at the same time, like, the conversation of it was interesting to listen to, like, you know, that perspective, mm-hmm. like, you know, that's why it does make sense, you know, if your entire goal, like, if you can deduce down, like, what you're physically training for and the why, even if you're just your everyday person, like, if you can figure that out going into the gym, you're just going to be so much more effective.
Yeah.
Well, okay, now let's talk about that. Let's talk about the average person. I'm not playing a sport, right?
Right.
I want to build some muscle, and I want to be in good aesthetic shape. But then I also want to be very functional, and I don't want to have pain. I don't want to have bad hip. I don't want to have achy hips and achy knees, and I want to have good mobility. You know, which one wins? And
this is a good discussion, yeah. Actually.
Well, this is where...
This is a great discussion.
This is definitely where you got to weave in and out of all of them.
And well, let me tell you...
yeah, because there's pluses and minuses to just doing one or the other,
and
right?
From personal experience over the last couple of years right now, you know, I've done more barbell lifting in the last 2 years than I have in my entire life, for sure,
mm-hmm.
by far. And I've seen more strength gains and muscle size than I ever have in my entire fitness career mm-hmm. now, which mm-hmm. is... awesome, considering that I've been lifting for 15 plus years. That's rare, right? It's, you see the bulk of your gains the first
part
of
your... Sure, it's not supposed to happen now, especially if you've been training that long.
Yeah, and especially being an older guy, right? And I attribute a lot of that to the barbell lifting, to getting into more deadlifting, more squatting, more overhead pressing, 100%. Now, that being said, I also have had more imbalances, more aches and pains, and more issues with my body than I ever have with that. Now, there's some factors that I think play into that. Is one of those is I got very addicted to the results that I was getting from the barbell squatting and deadlifting. I was gains. The gains were coming on fast, and I was enjoying it so much that I went from the guy who just 4 or 5 years before that was... you know, constant varying every workout. Like that was what I was notorious for. I used to say that I've never duplicated a workout. I used mm-hmm. to really say that. As a trainer, I used to say 10 years of lifting in my career, I've never duplicated a workout. That's how I trained. I trained every workout was unique and different, and I was always challenging my body in different ways. And there was a lot of good that came from that, but there was a lot that held me back, right? Yeah. I think it held me back from reaching my potential of what I could get by actually programming better and focusing on adaptation mm-hmm. by incorporating more barbell lifts. But what I did have I was very functional and I didn't have any aches and pains. I didn't have a lot of imbalances going on. Mm-hmm. And when I started heavy lifting with the barbell, it started to exaggerate some of those. And now they're very obvious to me.
Sure.
So
you have to look at, you know, where do imbalances come from? There's a few different places, but in a trained athlete, many times they come from overdeveloping a particular pathway or skill or, you know, over-strengthening your recruitment pattern.
Which is easy to do when you're getting after the barbell.
When you're too focused on one particular thing, whatever that may be.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when you're constantly, constantly varying things, there's really no opportunity to do that because it's always changing. But then you get the detriment of not really maximizing. That's why there's like a happy medium, right? Like mm-hmm. if all you do is like, if you just heavy squat and program squats all the time, you're going to get really good at squats. You'll probably build a lot of muscle.
Yeah.
But the odds of having imbalances or aches and pains that result from, or at least the common ones
mm-hmm.
that can come from a squat increase, the odds of it increase. So, you know, this is why it's so important to program these types of things, but going one way or just the other and saying like this is the only way to do it, which is, you know, people tend to do that, and I don't know why they do that.
You can
gain so much from all of that stuff. Like the way I would do it, if I were to do unilateral training, the way I would do it would be I would make it a phase.
Mm-hmm.
I would do like two.
That's kind of what I was alluding to, like by my getting into squats. Like I just, you know, like I didn't necessarily agree with the points, but I'm like, wow, that just made me think that I haven't done unilateral training specifically with that focus and intent in a long time. And so I was like, oh, I'm drawn to that. And also front loaded squats. Mm-hmm. And so these are two things that I feel like I'm always thinking ahead of that. Like, what movement haven't I focused on in a long time? And I'm very much more of a movement, like specific, I feel like a deficiency in a certain type of a movement, or mm-hmm. I'm not strong. Like, that's what I'm going to focus on. Not like, you know, my body part, or, you know, bringing my body up or this or that. So,
well, when you look at like, you know, if you're trying to look at it like a trainer or a coach who's coaching athletes, I got to think, and I didn't listen to the podcast or the books that you're reading right now, so I don't know if this is true or not, but I feel like if I'm in his position and I'm arguing unilateral movements over the backloaded barbell squat, I feel like as a coach, I could see it as the risk versus reward.
That's what, yeah.
That it's not that barbell squatting isn't good, and we can sit here and argue how great it is. It's the king of all exercises, but the risk is much greater than the guy who's doing the Bulgarian squat or is doing the single leg deadlift, because it's such a technical movement and you have to lighten the load in order to perfect the movement. So it doesn't allow so many of these imbalances to come out where I can cheat a deadlift up with both feet on the ground. Yeah. I can.
And you got to remember, he's dealing with a lot of like professional athletes that
rule number one is
it's preservation. Yes. Yeah. So it's a different mindset.
Right.
You know, a lot of them had to really train hard and build a crazy big, you know, muscular frame to mm-hmm. even get to that level. Now it's just like so many forces against them. They have to be able to absorb and react and, be solid. In their joints and supportive in their joints. And so that's like high priority.
And you also made the comment about how for athletes, gaining more muscle isn't necessarily, or many times is the opposite of what they would want to do.
Yeah.
There's a lot of sports where being heavy is always bad.
It's actually more rare that it's good.
If you play football to some extent, depending on your position, mass is going
to
make
if
you want that strength to body weight ratio.
It's always that. But like almost all sports that I can think of, even the combat sports are weight classes.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing that you'll notice, especially back in the day when MMA, I'll use MMA as an example, when the drug testing wasn't as, you know, whatever, and you saw more of these roided out athletes, is that they would go up a weight class because of this increased muscle that they got from their steroids and stuff. So now you've got a guy who's fighting at heavyweight who naturally should fight at light heavyweight, and the only way he got up to heavyweight was through the use of anabolics.
Mm-hmm.
But now he's fighting a dude that's a natural heavyweight.
Right.
Yeah.
And he's
comfortable in that.
They're comfortable weight, with that weight.
Know how to use it.
It's not so much muscle. Here's the thing with muscle, like carrying lots of physical muscle
mm-hmm.
requires a lot of energy and a lot of oxygen. So when you see a, you know, 220-pound, you know, dude where he's carrying a shit ton of muscle, then you see another 220-pound dude who's just naturally kind of that body weight and mm-hmm. is also fit, their stamina tends to be a little bit better. This is an observation that lots of coaches have made.
I could anecdotally, I had going through college football, like, because I was in a frame where I was like 185 in high school, and I was like, my strength to weight ratio was off the charts. You know, I was very strong for being 185 and lean and mean and mobile. And then
what do you walk around at right now? What do you weigh?
I'm at like 230.
Damn, that's a big difference.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I jettisoned up to that.
And some of your best lifts that you've talked about were done in college, right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, you're a pussy now, dude.
I know.
Damn it.
Well, you call me out like that.
I never asshole. Thought about that, though. I didn't realize that you were that light.
Well, in college, he was heavier than 185.
No, I was getting to, I got heavier than that is what I'm
saying. Oh, okay.
No, 185 was high school.
Okay, you're scaring me there, dude. I thought you were 185, setting all these big lifts
that
you've done. Man.
No, not the big lifts I talk about. I did that in college, yeah.
Okay.
High school, I did some impressive sort of lifts, like, you know, my bench was always good and squats, but anyways, like, yeah, in college, so they wanted me heavier because I had a different position. I was inside linebacker. I wasn't outside anymore. I wasn't strong safety. So
size is better.
They thought I needed more size. Yeah, because, I mean, you get pulling guards and you get, like, tackles, and there's some big boys. Like, I was going against, like, 380, 400-pound fuckers.
You're plugging the hole too a lot of times. So you got to go head-to-head with
some.
You're
taking on the fullback, you know, full sprint. And so, like, I had to build this shell. And so my whole summer, like, I just devoted to putting on size, and I just ate like a horse, like
lifted,
and all I had to do was just focus on lifting like super heavy and like maxing out.
How much did
weight,
you gain?
Dude.
You think over that summer?
Well, so I ended up coming back in season at 235.
Holy shit! Hold on, but how much? What did you start with?
So I was about 200.
You gained 30 fucking pounds over the summer?
I did.
Holy shit.
And it wasn't all muscle, I'm sure. Actually, I'm positive because I was not on anabolics. So. There was some fat there. And that stayed with me forever after that. But yeah, seriously, though.
You ruined your metabolism.
Oh, my God, dude. Can I just tell you how like heavy I felt? You know, like I was just not comfortable in that body. And
so you're like way bigger, you're thinking, okay,
so like lost mobility, I lost explosiveness, like, but I mean I could definitely take a hit and I could you know unleash a hit on somebody, but I was like winded.
Damn.
You know? It was gnarly.
Yeah, I mean, it's athletes are looking for that strength to weight ratio.
I taught a booty dad.
Exactly. You want to be for most sports, being big is okay so long as your strength comes up and you have this great ratio of strength to weight. If that starts to change to where you're still getting stronger, but the rate of strength is not going up at all to match your size.
Mm-hmm.
You're just moving more weight now. You're just a bigger, heavier person. And in some sports, like football, weight some weight's good, right? Especially if you're on the line or
position specific.
And you know, mass. You know, just moving mass. Physics shows that it's just going to hit you harder. But if you can't move that, you're not going to do well. And in a lot of sports, like cycling or, you know, but again, sports where there's a weight class, or you know, even baseball, you want to have a good strength to weight ratio. It's not the number one thing. But for the average person, like Adam was saying, who wants to like build muscle, the barbell movements are king. But you are going to run into problems
if you always live there.
Yeah, if you live, I've done this countless times to myself because I love barbells. I love barbell lifts. I love heavy pulling and squatting and pushing and all that stuff. And I've developed imbalances and overuse injuries as a result. I had shoulder surgery. I had my AC joint resected. It's probably about 10, 11 years ago, maybe longer actually, probably 13 years ago. And it was because I had pushed bench press so much for so much of my life. And I had become so one-dimensional that I had created an imbalance and had to get surgery. And I can never press like I did before now as a result. I've had hip bursitis from just squatting heavy all the time and, it, you know, not working on the unilateral stuff. And even till this day, my unilateral work is like, you could see what I could lift with a barbell and I should be able to lift so much with a dumbbell or unilaterally. And it's not even close to that.
Yeah.
Because that's something I focus on. So, which is now, believe it or not, ironically, now that I have a garage gym, I'm going to probably do less barbell movements, which is funny considering in a garage you tend to do more, but I'm going to be doing more unilateral stuff. So
that's a big priority for me right now. So I started incorporating that maybe a month or so ago. And you know, that video you're talking about that I shot was kind of a progression to that, of me I've been working on this. So that wasn't the first time that I obviously attempted something similar to that. So, and I'm at 220 now, so I'm weighing 220. And I'm still able to do stuff like that. So we're going to see how far I can get with my weight while I maintain that. And a big part of me being able to push the weight and still do that is actually unilateral movement. So I've already done that, and that was already a priority of mine because I did put that together the last time that I went really aggressive on gaining was I went so much barbell, then I got really stiff and rigid, you know, strong. Fuck, I was strong. I was really strong and felt like I put on some, I mean, my back made gains and my legs made gains in the last couple of years that I hadn't seen in the previous 10 plus in lifting. So that part of it, but it also exaggerated these imbalances. So I'm sure those imbalances were there before, right? And that's what I mean by it's because of the barbell. Because it's not like, because if you lift a barbell correctly and perfect with good form, you shouldn't have any imbalances from that. But all it takes is to be off just a little bit. And when you're pulling up 500 pounds, you know, it really exaggerates that imbalance. And that's where you get these.
It's not just that, though. It's also just, I don't care what movement you do. I don't care if it's unilateral, barbell, whatever. If you do the same thing, the same movement all the time.
Yeah.
And this is what, and this is, I think, the bigger problem. I don't necessarily think the barbell promotes imbalances as much as people love barbell movements and always inject them. Like every, like chest day, you know, people are bench pressing all the time, or, you know, deadlifting, you know, every week, or squatting twice or 3 days a week all the time. That's, I think, more what may contribute to problems. Because it's, imagine if you did any exercise all the time.
Do you think, I mean, I don't know if that, I don't know if that's a true statement or not, because I feel like what we've seen in the last few years, as far as deadlifting and squatting, it's been huge. And we, you know, we attributed that to CrossFit, right? And so we've seen a lot more of that. I mean, it still blows my mind that I can go to Gold's and actually have to wait for a squat rack where that just didn't happen 10 years ago. But I still think that,
maybe it's just how you, maybe a better, a more accurate statement wouldn't necessarily be how often you do it.
Intensity. Yeah.
Intensity, how you program it and what you do around it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Cause I definitely highly recommend, I would tell someone, don't ever stop. I mean, I think a good compound barbell lift should be in every lift, you know, or every workout somewhere in there. Like, you know, like Justin was saying right now, like he picks two compound lifts and then builds around that. I think that's I think you just should do some unilateral stuff with that and multi-planar stuff with that, you know. So it's like you
it's do joint your specific yeah too. It's not yeah because that's the thing. It's like I want to express overall, like, you know, how my body's going to respond and give the right strength signal, but now also I want to be joint specific so I know where my imbalances lie and I can address them and build, you know, around that and strengthen them.
Mm-hmm. I remember years ago I was a kid, I was young, I think I was a teenager, and I always bench pressed. And I think I don't remember what the number was, but I got stuck at a particular number. And I had read some article.
135?
Yeah. When I was 14.
Right.
I know. And I read some article where some old-time bodybuilder said one of the best ways to get your bench press to go up was to do dumbbell chest press only for like a little while. And then go back to the barbell.
Uh-huh.
It actually worked.
Yeah, for sure.
I remember that.
I remember the exact same.
Really?
Exact same thing.
Just phasing it. Yeah.
It was so, but it's. I mean, it worked.
Yeah.
You know, I got better at the dumbbell.
Did the same thing when I did really like low and intensified ring push-ups. You know, suspended ring push-ups. Mm. You know, it's just like it was a totally different stimulus. Now all of a sudden I got even more strength in my depth of my, you know, the pressing movement. Mm-hmm. So it all contributed. It all bleeds into the overall.
I actually used to do something with that. Now that you brought that up, you brought back a memory of that. I had that exact same epiphany, right, where I was like, "Oh shit, let's go this direction." And what ends up happening is you start normally. Most people start with the barbell, right, and they start barbell pressing a lot, and then they realize that they're weaker dumbbell pressing, and it's like it's not cool to, you know, lift 50-pound dumbbells when you could barbell press 225, right? So it's like, yeah, avoid it.
You look like a lot more of a beast.
Right, and I actually remember reading something very similar, Sal, and then I was like, okay, you know, fuck this. I need to take my ego out. I'm gonna do dumbbells. And I actually stuck with dumbbells until I got to the point where I was moving almost the same weight with the dumbbells as I was with the barbells.
So whereas both dumbbells add up to the weight.
Yes, okay. Wow. And then I came back to the barbell, and then worked on the barbell until I progressed that weight. Then I'd go back to the dumbbell. And that was kind of how I went back and forth. This is way before MAPS and phasing and, you know, undulating our programming like we do now. But that's kind of what I used to do in the past is I would stick with barbell for a while. And then when I feel like I'm slowing my progression down, then I would switch over to dumbbells. And I use that for like basically all muscle groups. So I would do the same thing for like a shoulder press and then I would work over the dumbbells and then I'd go back and forth. So that was kind of how I phased those things, you know.
Well, it reinforces the stabilization of your shoulder, you know, like, so now you have two to accommodate for that are independent. And so it definitely carries over to now I have a solid, you know, barbell where I'm like equally loaded, you know, as I'm coming down. It's like I did all that work, stabilizing work that contributed to the overall strength. It's crazy. Mm.
Doug, you wanted us to review some celebrity diets or something?
Yeah. I mean, they...
We're going to grade them.
Celebrity diets. Should we have a song?
Are these like
for this?
Popular celebrity things that are going on right,
right.
now?
Right. So there's a number of diets out there that are popular among celebrities, and I wanted to get your take on those.
They're our favorite people.
Mm. I'm going to just give you my opinion before I even hear them.
Okay. There you go.
They know a lot about nutrition, probably more than us.
I take all my advice from celebrities. I'm just kidding. Yeah. All
right, they are the authority, are they not?
Yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to start with the first one I found here, which is the five-factor diet. Have you heard of that?
From a Kardashian or
no,
what?
No, no.
Oh, I actually have one of those. I do have one from the Kardashians.
Oh, thank God, Doug. Thank
I have to have one of those.
Please. Can't wait.
The five-factor diet.
Yeah. And so what this is...
Five components of fitness.
It comes from the number of elements each meal should include, which are protein, complex carbs, fiber, fat, and fluids. Followers eat five meals a day with recipes that contain no more than five ingredients. One cheat day is allowed per week where you can eat anything and everything you like.
That's
guilt-free.
Anything and
my favorite
everything.
Diet. I've never heard of this. My favorite diet. I've ever heard.
Yeah, yeah. And it's followed.
Ooh, sugar butter cubes.
It's followed by Lady Gaga, Megan Fox, Kate Beckinsale, Katy Perry, and so on.
If Megan Fox follows it, it's a pass for me right away.
Yep.
So
no,
I go ahead and agree with you.
By the way, just for the listeners to know, this is what happens when someone comes out with a new diet or something, and they've got like some money behind them. They get on the phone and they call.
You're a beautiful movie star.
They
want to do what she's doing.
They call super celebrity, whatever, whoever, and then the celebrity, you know, answers the phone to their publicist and like, hey, is so and so willing to say that they're
attach
following my diet?
Brand.
For percent of the sales, or for $50,000, I'll be like, sure, and that's it. So I highly doubt they do this. The five elements are protein, fiber, carbohydrates, something else, and then fluids.
Yeah,
and you have to include all those in every meal, and you have to have five meals a day. But nothing can have more than five ingredients.
Right.
So what they've done they've effectively eliminated heavily processed foods.
Yeah.
Potentially.
Because I can still get crazy if I wanted to.
Oh, so you... Okay, wait.
So nothing you eat can have more than five ingredients in it.
That's correct. They're supposed to all include protein, complex carbs, fiber, fat, and fluids.
Okay, you got to give me an example of this. I got to see. Can we see it on the TV or can you
I'll have to find one.
Or read it. That's fine.
I'll dig up
fiber,
one.
Fat, or
fluids. I'm trying to build...
All fluids?
I'm trying to build a meal in my head right now that only has five ingredients.
Well, chicken. No, not the whole meal. Each food in the meal cannot have more than five ingredients. So, like chicken breast.
Oh, so it's trying to encourage whole foods over something that's packaged and has 15 things inside of it.
Exactly. Super generic way to do it.
Like chicken versus chicken nuggets.
Let's talk about that. Okay, so this is what I think is clever and smart.
Oh, wait a minute. Is this their sample dish?
Yeah,
right
sample
here?
One.
Hold on. Read breakfast.
What's breakfast?
Breakfast, five-factor French toast.
Five-factor French toast.
Wow, hold on. Nice. Hold on. Tell me what the morning snack is.
How's the bread prepared?
Morning snack is five-factor berry shake.
I wonder, hey guys, real quick, I wonder how they're making money.
Is bread just like oats?
Can you guys guess how they're making money?
Keep going.
Do they have a five-factor supplement company?
Is it a five? Yeah.
So next up is lunch, which is chef salad made with fresh lettuce, tomato, roasted turkey, boiled egg whites, and seasoned with Mrs. Dash.
Mm. They got paid by Mrs. Dash.
Afternoon snack. Non-fat French onion sour cream dip with celery.
No fat, please. No.
Dinner, salmon, quinoa, salad, salt, pepper.
So it's not an unhealthy diet except for the five-factor French toast and five-factor berry shake.
Five-finger fist punch.
Well, okay, so... It, like almost every diet, you take a little bit of something positive or a little bit of science and you gift wrap it with a Megan Fox and you give it a very clever name that's catchy.
It's pretty bow.
And it's easy to follow, you know, so it's clever, right? It's clever. It's, you know, it's tied to someone super hot.
And then don't forget, once a week... You can fucking go crazy.
And then there's
this encourages really good.
I love those cheat days.
And almost all diets will have something that is appealed, that everyone appeals to, right? Like the peanut butter.
Let your hair down Sunday.
They get something in there that everybody's going to be like, oh, that is fucking awesome. Yeah, but it's like
it's shit. Yeah. It's shit.
Well, you shouldn't say it's shit, right? Like, someone followed this diet, a lot of people would be better off following this than following the American.
Jesus Christ, any diet's going to be better than...
Well, I know, but okay, here's the thing. Let's talk...
follow the cucumber diet and it'll be healthy.
What I want us to try and do, because we all know... Doug doesn't even need to tell me the next 3 or 4 diets that he found.
You never know.
We're going to be able to shit on all of them. But let's talk about, like, if I had... And I would like us all to vote on whichever ones we think is the best.
I got an idea. Why don't we go through...
One out of five. What do you get? Okay. That's what
we'll
do. Rate it.
We'll go through all however many, and then we'll rank them.
How many fingers you give them? I give them the middle.
All right. This next one is followed by Nicole Richie, Rooney Mara, and Gwen Stefani.
Oh. Mm.
It's the pressed juicery diet.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah. Let's please not chew.
Six juices a day, 1,200 calories.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Followers receive a daily supply of juices specially delivered every morning. Each fresh, nutrient-packed drink is designed to replace meals and snacks, and all alcohol, caffeine, and nicotine should be avoided.
Sounds anabolic.
Wait a minute.
Now this...
The whole fucking diet is
all shit. It's just mush.
All shakes. Now, that is a shitty diet, bro. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
So, I feel like at least the five...
The first one was way better than this
one. Come on, dude. The first one, like, if my client came to me and said, Adam,
this is a one-finger diet.
My five-factor diet meal plan is fucking working great for me, and I really enjoy it, and I looked at it, and I saw it, I'd be like, okay. Yeah. It's better than a lot of shit that's out there.
Open your mouth and we pour it in.
Can we see these shakes? Are you kidding me right now?
You know what? Press Juicery. That's the place we used to get our we get those smoothies. Remember, we'd go and have them. They'd make those coconut drinks. They're really good.
Right.
So here's the problem with juices. You're eliminating a lot of the good stuff from whatever you're juicing.
Yeah, were you just lazy?
By squeezing out the juice.
Right, because most fruit, like the skin and stuff and the seeds are like...
Or vegetables, like the fibers. Yeah,
that's where all the good stuff is.
And you're just concentrating the hell out of the sugar.
Yeah. If somebody handed me one, I'd probably drink it, but
look at this.
Lazy.
And of course, you have to buy their juices. I mean, so here's another thing you need to understand about supplements, and this is a supplement. A very effective strategy for a supplement company is to construct a diet around their supplement.
Yeah.
You sell the diet, but in order to follow the diet, you have to take their products. So you're not selling the supplement.
It's the formula.
So they're not coming out saying, hey, our juices are the best juices. They're saying, this is the best diet.
Yep.
And then you buy the diet, and because you bought the diet...
Oh, by the way, right, it's specifically...
Hey man, when I used to sell memberships at the gym, I'd sell personal training, number one, because I knew that people needed it, but number two, because I knew if they had training...
You have to have a membership.
They have to have a membership.
You need a multivitamin, at least a couple fat burners.
How does this work right here? Cleanse one, cleanse two, cleanse three?
Nothing, they just deliver you the juices. So you have no food, you eat no hard food or whatever.
Oh my God.
Yeah, you just drink them.
This would be a miserable
diet. This is good if you don't have any teeth. So if you're...
You're right. If you're bedridden,
toothless. If you have no teeth, you should try the pressed juicery.
I want some juices.
Next one, Doug.
Yeah, sure. I found this one. It's Victoria Beckham is following this one. It's the alkaline...
David Beckham's wife?
Yeah.
Ooh, oh, okay. Another hot... She's already... I like this diet.
Smoke show.
I feel like it's going to be a good one.
It's an alkaline diet. Diet rich in fruits and vegetables that curtails consumption of acid-forming foods like dairy, pasta, meat, and fish. The goal, to keep the body's pH balance between 7.35 and 7.45.
pH balance for
her.
Jennifer Aniston, Kirsten Dunst.
Good luck with that.
Gwyneth Paltrow also like this.
Good luck with keeping it right there all day.
Well, no, you're out. Okay, hold on a second. People need to know something. Your body maintains a certain level no matter what.
I'm so alkaline.
It's really fucking good at doing that, number one. Number two, this whole alkaline, acidic type process that or sales pitch that people are using with diets and stuff, when people tend to eliminate certain foods because they're acidic and replace them with other foods that tend to be alkaline, the alkaline foods that are recommended are like really healthy foods, like, you know, spinach and kale and all these amazingly healthy foods. And so they think it's because they've made their body more alkaline, when in reality...
Right. You stopped eating candy bars out of a wrapper, and now you're eating kale.
Find me a...
What do you think is going to happen?
That's it. That's really what's
going on. Can you
pull
that one up, Doug? Can I see that one too? I'd like to see it.
You like to see what, the pictures of it?
Yeah. No, I like to see what we're talking about. Yeah, no. You know, I want to see... Just in case I decide to get it, you know?
No, there's no fear of your body going too acidic or too... By the way, too alkaline will would be bad too. Alkaline burns you just like acid does, right? Is it a base?
Base.
Sorry.
This is different. This is pretty popular right now, though. In the alkaline water,
it's like cleaner.
You got the waters and the drinks now. They're supposed to make you more alkaline. You have this test that people are doing. Like some gyms, like they do this. They'll test you. And they'll be like, "Oh wow, your pH is off. Take this. You know,
how the fuck do they test it?
You're so acidy.
Your pH is always kind of the same. Yeah. Your body kind of regulates that.
What do you mean? It's like
your body.
You have a cup of coffee, and it throws that off. It's always moving, dude. Yeah.
What are they?
It's very sensitive. Your pH balance is very, very sensitive. It's just like a plant. Like when you overfeed nutrients, like if you give a lot of nutrients, like more than your body actually needs at a sitting, right? It will fluctuate the pH levels up and down. So it could easily fluctuate. That's why I said good luck at keeping it in that range, because a cup of coffee will throw it off.
VO2. People test VO2.
Yeah, it's exactly. That's a good analogy, because VO2 is something that is forever moving on us, and you can manipulate that in 2 days. And that's how, so this is what they used to do. Like they'll take these tests, right? These people will do these like finger
litmus tests.
The finger prick test, and they'll test your blood real quick, and then they'll tell you like, oh my God, you're so far off, and then they'll give you these supplements to like take this for a couple of days, come back and test, and you'll come back and you'll be like, you'll swing the other way.
Yeah, but no, here's the thing. Like I'm looking this up, and this is what I thought, because I kind of read this. The idea that that diets can materially affect blood pH for the purpose of treating a range of diseases has zero support, zero scientific support. There's nothing to support this. If your blood is actually in acidosis or alkalosis, that's very dangerous or potentially serious, but I think you'd know. It's not like you're walking around going, I'm fat.
Appeals to people's like heartburn. Like what? Because you're like, oh, acid. Like, I got to get rid of my acid. Just got to eat a better balanced diet.
I want to hear the next one, Doug.
Well, the next one is a headline first off. It says, Kourtney Kardashian reveals her insanely strict detox diet.
No detoxing. We're detoxing now.
So, anybody want to venture a guess what this might include?
Detox.
In the morning, I have
cayenne pepper.
Super antioxidant drink.
I have lemon juice.
I have cocaine in the morning, and then I don't eat until the evening.
This is the coolest diet we've done yet.
Oh, I don't eat.
Okay, so I'm going to read off what she does
every day.
Except
for this little product.
So for breakfast, she eats a minimal amount of fruit and usually opts in for her go-to avocado smoothie.
Mm.
For lunch and dinner,
blend it up. It's
she
so hard
sticks
to eat.
To proteins like fish and chicken and maybe some cauliflower, rice, or broccoli. Following dinner, she's not allowed to eat breakfast for 14 to 16 hours. Oh yeah, and one day per week, she does a 24-hour fast, which she only drinks water and bone broth. Mm.
Do you know what these celebrities
have
done?
You know what
we've turned dieting into? And this is what it fucking annoys me.
What do you mean we've turned into?
We've turned it into like a...
competitive.
No. It's turned into like a, like it's a fad. It's a cool thing. Like, what diet are you on right now? What are you trying? What do you, and it's, they're in search, like, because I bet you money if you actually Google search Kardashian and all the different diets that she's tried over the last 10 years, I bet you there's a whole shitload.
This is working so well for me this week.
And this is what's wrong with America, is that we have this on or off the wagon, and everybody is debating over whose diet is better, when in reality the reason why any of them and all of them are seeing results or change from any of the fucking diets is because they go from mindless eating where they eat all the shit in front of them and don't pay attention to all of a sudden now I'm trying to exercise and pay attention. And you could follow any diet and do that, and you're going to see the same results.
You know what
much.
All these
I'm zoning I'm Mediterranean I'm
you know
paleo.
What all these diets have in common? They're all low calorie.
Yeah, right. That's the number one thing that they all have in common, is they all go back to law of thermodynamics, right? So it's, they all restrict the shit out of you calories. You put anybody and everybody on a 1,300 to 1,500 calorie diet, and I promise.
And this is all like how skinny she's getting. It's like there's no health like promotion in here, is there, Doug?
Well, this Kardashian, what's her name? Something Kourtney Kardashian.
Kourtney. Yeah.
Her, I mean, what she's saying doesn't sound bad.
No.
It
I know,
sounds
that's
healthy,
what I'm saying, but like highlight the health of it.
But they make it sound like it's like there's
like
some,
it's this cheat,
like
know,
there's
like,
magic
ew,
in it.
She hacked the system.
Yeah, no, it's there's nothing wrong.
All right, you want more of these?
Yeah, we want more.
I can't get enough.
Tom Brady and Gisele Bündchen. Is that how you say
her
name?
That is a hot power couple.
Bündchen.
Bunchen?
Bunchen?
Justin's like, I'd hit it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one?
Brady. Yes. Tom Brady.
Dude, he's got five Super Bowls. You know,
I wear your rings.
You know, I'm tempted.
I'd hit it.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So
at least for one of those rings.
Their diet is about 80% plant-based and 20% lean meats. They have no dairy, no sugar, no flour, no olive oil, no nightshade vegetables. And for Tom, no strawberries.
What is the Sal? What,
doesn't get strawberries?
What's the nightshade thing? That's the second time I've heard that this week.
Nightshade vegetables like eggplant.
No, I understand what are tomatoes, eggplant. Yeah, like yeah. I understand
but
which
what's
ones.
The deal with them?
Yeah, why? What's bad about them?
What's the deal?
So they tend to be more common in intolerances. So if you take vegetables and you look at the ones that tend to bother people with gastro issues or digestive issues and stuff like that, or if people go and get like these actual food intolerance tests that test antibodies, not for food allergies, but for intolerances, nightshades are up there. And dietitians have known for a long time that if they, that for people with, you know, irritable bowel syndrome, one of the things that they'll turn to remove from a person's diet that'll make them feel better is nightshade vegetables. So that's why it's probably in there as being removed. And it looks like that's what they did. They eliminated all the common food intolerances people have, except for why do they remove olive oil? That's weird.
Yeah, that is weird.
I'm offended. You know what I mean? Olive oil is good for your hair.
You know,
it's like good for everything.
Staple. That's really interesting. And with someone like Tom Brady, who I feel like out of all the people we've named so far is on the better end of the smarter group out of all these celebrities.
Yeah.
not because he's a badass football player.
Not at all.
I mean,
we're not biased.
I'm a little biased because of that too. But. Yeah. I'd be interested to see if he was put on this diet because he actually had somebody look into.
It sounds like it because he's avoiding strawberries too.
Right. Like, I mean, so what
which
I
is so like
where
specific.
I don't and so far I like the first diet and his diet the best. If I'm like, if we're voting on like, you know, what would I tell someone is a pretty good diet that some celebrity's doing right now? What he's doing is
well, it'd be interesting if he had like a continuous glucometer. He had some kind of monitoring his reaction to these different types of foods, and maybe that was the thought process where they extracted it. You know, so if there was that much thought that went into that specifically,
God, I mean, the individuality.
That'd be cool.
It's so crazy, like the new science that's coming out with the individual responses to food.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to shit on every diet.
Dude, no.
Oh, yeah. Well, there won't be any more diets, dude, once this gets completely like mainstream.
It just echoes what the three of us have seen.
Mm-hmm.
We've been trainers for a long time. We've been in fitness for a long time.
That's why we refuse to make
it
a mind
never,
pump diet.
It's right.
No diet diet.
It never blows me away. It never ceases to blow me away when I'll run into people or train people whose body responds so different from other people. For a little while there as a trainer, because we were taught this actually early on, that not eating animal products is not good because you'll lack certain vitamins and minerals. You need to get them from meat. But then as a personal trainer, I had several clients who just felt and did their best completely avoiding meat altogether. And I remember thinking like, are they lying? Like, it can't be. I see what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's obviously their individual body makeup. So it's so much more complicated than we think. So, I mean, I'm with you, Adam. I think because Tom Brady's diet sounds like someone came out and tested him and said, here's what you're going to do. Because like they eliminated some foods that are actually healthy, like strawberries. And nightshade vegetables, by the way, are very healthy. If you don't have an intolerance to them, you shouldn't avoid them.
Well, and I was joking about him being the smartest, but what true story, the guy is like the one known as one of the most prepared football players to ever play the game. Yeah. And like literally
he's a goat.
He's to the detail on every single thing
he's
that he
does. He's almost as awesome as Montana.
So
Montana.
No, he already blew all that away.
Know, he did,
yeah, that's no longer
that was a depressing
that's
day.
No longer a debate anymore, buddy.
easier
so,
no,
yeah, yeah, so yeah, yeah. So that being said, he strikes me as
like
the guy who would probably fly the top researchers. I mean, the guys that we get to talk to, like that, because why we talk all the time, like just going to shit on everybody's diets, like in the future. I guarantee he has access to those type of people.
Yeah.
He, to me, is somebody who would actually reach out to somebody to put him on a specific diet for his body versus Kim Kardashian or whatever the Kardashian. They seem like the type
sign this check.
Yes,
cool.
That would get a phone call from a company that says, listen, we're going to pay you $1 million or X amount of dollars in royalties.
Fit T, sure. year.
Yeah, that.
Well, when that much money is dependent.
I'm speculating too, by the way. I can't prove.
No, actually, this is what happened.
That's all we can do.
I think I read about this. I actually think I read about him doing a specific diet because he's getting older. He wanted to perform better, so he followed this diet and training that made him, you know, perform the way he did recently, which was very good. But you know, it makes you kind of wonder with these, you know, especially with these professional athletes, the amount of money they make and the amount of money that they invest in themselves and their bodies to perform, and how tech is moving in the future. It's going to be very interesting. I mean, you guys know that they've grown meat in a laboratory,
yeah,
right? And they actually have eaten it.
Yeah.
So they've gotten stem cells, grown a steak.
It doesn't taste good.
In a lab, and then people eat it. And you're right.
That's what they said.
You're right. People said it didn't taste good, but I think they came out with another generation of it.
Mm.
And it tasted just fine. It's more expensive to do that than to raise an animal. But at some point...
Like how...
At some point, you got to think about, like, in the future, like,
well,
you got a super rich athlete.
So let's talk
is
about...
Is that living tissue?
It is. It's stem cells. It's cells.
Okay. So, okay.
So are still well, you think, living you tissue. Think vegan, yeah. You think vegans are going to be against that or no? Because I feel like it's like, that's close.
Well, no, that's why
that's closer
I'm
to
sure
tofu,
they're happy.
Right? That's, like more, that's more tofu than it is cow.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean...
is it?
Like you're creating flesh and murdering it. No.
What was tripping me out is like way in the future, I mean, they could test your body, find out your individual chemical makeup, and then like grow your food for you. So like, this is the perfect meat for you. This
dude, you know what? Do you know what Justin and I just heard on a podcast? The prediction that by 2046.
2045.
Is it 45?
I think so. What, the singularity?
No, that not singularity. That we will actually be able to stay alive forever.
Yeah, immortal.
Yeah.
So it's,
So you guys know that he works for Google now, right?
I didn't know.
Do you know who he is?
Ray Kurzweil.
Yeah, he's like this futurist that that has already he's made lots of predictions in the past, and they've come true. And he uses this, you know, he looks at a lot of different things like Moore's law and you know, a lot of different calculations, and he calculates, you know, and figures out that, you know, the singularity is going to happen at this particular point, and at this particular point we'll figure out this particular this thing. And he's been on point. It's pretty crazy. But I think he works for Google with their AI like department, like to create like
I know they've put a lot of money into that.
Yeah, pretty interesting. Are there any diets left there, Doug?
Okay, let's wrap it up with Katy Perry's M plan.
Oh, it's only appropriate.
The M plan.
The M plan.
She's gone downhill lately.
M&Ms.
That would be a good one.
Yeah.
It requires
you
one
eat 3 M&Ms a day.
That's it green. Would work.
3 M&Ms.
No, it requires one meal per day to be mushroom based.
That's
better. No. This is even better yet. The diet can magically target specific areas of unwanted fat while leaving the breasts unaffected.
No, this is great. Oh, that's my winner. That is the best.
Yes.
Please pull
Let's
this
not
up.
Touch some breasts,
guys. Can I just say something right now?
Breast
why don't we? Why don't we just do? Why don't we do this?
Wow, I love that.
Here's what I think we should do. I think she looks fucking crazy too. Yeah. Here's what I want to do. I think we should do this, and only people that will be in on it will be Mind Pump fans and us. Let's make up a bullshit diet.
Oh my
like,
God.
Like, hey, we've designed a specific diet that
it'll
makes you
taint
lose,
us forever. I saw
it'll make you lose the fat you want, plus make your dick grow or something stupid like that, right?
Oh my God. I saw the greatest video. It was like this conspiracy that she was like part of the lizard people. I swear to God. Like that Russell Brand or whatever like left her because they were like married.
Because
she's a lizard person. I lost my shit. We have to watch that one.
Dude, so this diet reeks of... Like, you know, someone sitting, a group of people sitting in a room and they're like, hey, what would sound cool?
Yeah.
Oh, I know this. What if like one of the meals is all mushrooms? Yeah.
Listen,
you need to read that. You need to read that one more time.
And your boobs
are going to target the fat cells, but not the breasts.
The new diet that claims replacing a meal a day with mushrooms.
Read it all out. Yeah.
Well, help
it
women
makes a lot of sense.
Shed fat, but only in certain parts of the body.
Yeah.
The waist, hips, and thighs.
Oh, good.
But not the bust.
Good.
Yeah. Wow, that sounds perfect.
Yeah.
I wonder, you know, I think everybody would want that fucking diet. Nothing's wrong with mushrooms.
These
by
must
the way.
Be psychedelic
Magic
mushrooms.
Exactly, dude. Yeah.
These are psychedelic mushrooms that you're eating.
Here's the little, yeah.
Like, oh my God.
Take these mushrooms.
The fine print at the bottom.
Imagine like, what you want to look like, and that's what you'll look like.
Well,
it has to be magical.
So I want to go ahead and retract what I said earlier, which was most of these diets take a little bit of science, and then they fucking
there's
create
zero.
I don't know if there's any science around this
This diet pushed by by the mushroom farmers of America.
It's so great. You can tell.
We got to miss some mushrooms.
You see the sidebar, all the stuff that gets promoted for Doug. Because, you know, that's kind of scary that Doug,
you got to
put your laptop up on this computer. It totally gives away anything that you've been Google searching lately. Because it just popped up, like, because obviously we're doing weight loss and diet stuff.
The donkey show.
There was a diet. There was a diet gimmick on the right. And then there was the cameras, which I know you just bought your new camera. So it's being advertised. It's going to be funny when Doug pulls this up on the TV one day and we get to like some big dildo.
Amazon.
For half off.
I'm not searching them.
Rush ordered.
4 foot dildo, half off.
Vibrating.
It's only 2 feet.
Yeah. Get it now at Amazon Prime.
I like to get dildos as tall as I am.
Now with bolstered grip.
I like to wrestle a mime. No, man. This is horrible. And celebrities promoting this. That's what they do, right? Celebrities promote.
All right, dude.
Bullshit.
That's why I did not want you guys started just murdering the first diet, and I knew it was going to get worse. I knew that. I was like, when I was listening to it, I'm like, you know what? For a celebrity diet, this
that was
is not
the most reasonable.
This is not half bad. I've seen a lot worse. And then Doug just proved me right by going on with the rest. Oh, Kelly Osbourne does this one too, huh?
Magic
mushrooms.
She's done a lot of drugs.
It must work for.
They learned this watching the Smurfs.
Speaking of like people need to know this, like. Food organizations and unions and groups or whatever, they do get together and they do figure out ways to get Americans to eat more.
How do we get them to buy into the shit?
Dude, no joke.
Yeah, it's the grains, like the cereal came out of nowhere.
The cartoon Popeye with the spinach, that was supported and pushed by farmers that grew spinach.
Well, if you
back then it was like healthy things though.
So if you read the book,
but it was brilliant.
If you read the book Hitmakers, it gets into this actually. It's actually really fascinating. And Disney is one of the biggest culprits of this. So they have created just like this controlling the way we think through these storytelling through these cartoons.
Oh, dude, like if I tell you guys right now, what food should you eat if you want to get better eyesight?
Like Bambi.
No. Like what food?
Carrots.
Carrots, right?
Yeah.
Completely made up.
Right. Totally. Yeah.
By the industry, by the people that sell carrots, you know, spinach or, you know, milk for your bones because it has calcium.
Bones,
like all these different things, which is funny,
which
by the way.
I bought into like, 1,000%.
Yeah. By the way.
Or an apple a day keeps the doctor
or
away.
No, remember the milk, the bodybuilder that would drink milk, like that commercial in the 80s?
Yeah.
Dude, I vividly remember that's why I wanted to start build muscle.
And drugs are like scrambling eggs.
Yeah. Use your brain on drugs.
That didn't work.
Yeah.
Apparent, but like,
it's like ooh.
And of course I got the message.
All stoners are like, I'm hungry now.
I got the message that spinach built muscle. So here I am eating a fuck ton of spinach.
And look at you.
And I'm not putting on any size. I'm a 15-year-old kid. My mom's like, Sal, you want more steak? I'm like, no.
Spinach.
No, I need more.
I'm going to eat all the spinach because it's going to make me buff.
Give me spinach and carrots, mom.
Why am I losing weight? How about the spinach diet I should be getting?
Yeah. I'm shitting all the time.
Here.
You know, I think the moral of the story here is
don't listen to celebrities.
Yeah, that's the first one.
Definitely.
And really, I think what people need to take away, and I think what we talk a lot about, even when we talked about the ketogenic diet back then, and we talked about the health benefits of that, we had to be very careful that we were explaining to people that, listen, we're not saying that this is the diet everybody should follow. There's some health benefits to doing that, and it definitely fits for some people with special needs. And I really think that most diets like that, like your ketogenic, your paleo, I think there is a good reason for someone to follow that if it is a something medically wrong with them that could benefit. Like you got cancer, like I could see putting my family member that got diagnosed with that on like a ketogenic diet. But everyone going after these diets for weight loss, really all of them work because they're all restricting calories. I mean, that's the main reason of them work.
I'd like to see a diet that has you eat more calories than you burn and then you lose weight. Right. I'd like to see that magic. You know what I mean?
Right.
Show me that diet. That's the fucking best diet of all time.
Right, right.
It doesn't
just
happen.
Just write it and put it out there.
Yeah.
And I think
people will buy it.
And again, I mean, this goes back to why I'm such a fan of tracking is that, you know, just being mindful of what you're consuming.
That's the new diet we're going to write.
Right? Mm. Just
the
track.
Tracking diet.
Just the tracking diet. Eat whatever you want. Yeah. Just track. Because
just track it.
I tell you what, like, when you start looking.
It's hard work.
Actually, you're forced to look at what you're eating all day long. Sometimes you go, my God.
First step is awareness.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
The awareness diet.
The awareness
diet. Oh, I wrote that one. Yeah, I call it.
You call it.
Oh,
I don't know. I think I said it first here.
Somebody ran with our blubber diet, right?
Yeah. Oh, the Inuit diet?
The Inuit diet.
Hey, you know what's going on. I'm pretty excited. All month long, right? What are we doing this month? Probably one of the we're doing the BOGO. What are we calling it?
Oh,
BOGO?
It's not all month long.
Oh no, it's till the 12th.
It ends on the 12th.
It is BOGO.
The BOGO.
Damn it, you almost got us in trouble, Adam.
The 12th, the BOGO.
BOGO, buy one get one. It's our first time ever doing that. So it's the super bundle, the MAP super bundle, which has all of our programs.
The goal is to get your friend involved. You know you have a friend that needs mind
you
bump in their
accountability.
Life, but they're absolutely too stubborn. So what you need to do is blow their mind away with the fucking best programming out there in the market. You need to get them the free one or trick them into giving you half the money for
tell
yours.
Tell them to buy it and then you get it. Yeah.
Or you could just get them to buy it and then you get the free one.
That's what I'm saying.
You're real closer. Really good. If you're a real closer.
But yeah, it's got all the programs.
That's the assumption close.
It's a year's worth of training, programming, priming. It's got, everything you could want, and you get a free one for enrolling in it. It's the first time we've ever done something like this, and it's only going on until the 12th. So you can find out about it at mindpumpmedia.com. Also, we post a brand new video on YouTube every single day. What you want to do is you want to go to YouTube, you want to look up Mind Pump TV and subscribe so that you can get notifications when we post new videos, which is every single day. Lastly, check us out on Instagram. My page is Mind Pump Sal. Adam is Mind Pump Adam. Justin is Mind Pump Justin. And Doug is Mind Pump Doug.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.